So good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming. So I'm very honored, I feel very honored to introduce Dr. Enrique Rodriguez-Boulan today. We are very lucky to have him here today. He's very busy and traveling a lot. He's an outstanding scientist who is famous for his work in cell biology and in RPE and in epithelial biology. And let me briefly tell you a little bit about his academic career. So he's from Argentina, and he received his MD. Can you hear me all? Or shall I talk through the microphone? It's okay? Okay. So Dr. Rodriguez-Boulan is from Argentina. He received his MD from the University of Buenos Aires. And then after 3 years of training in biophysics, he transferred to the United States, to NYU in New York, and trained there as a cell biologist. And during that time, as a postdoc, and subsequently as when he moved into assistant professor position, he co-developed the MDCK model and used it to study how epithelial polarity is established and maintained. And for example, one of his really key papers is that his laboratory discovered in 1978 that enveloped viruses can be budded from MDCK cells in a polarized manner. So this was one of the first papers that showed that molecules can be expressed and localized in a polarized manner. He then became associate professor at Weill Cornell Medical University, or Medical College, and this was in the Department of Cell Biology. He also became Joseph Hinsey Professor for Cell Biology, and then subsequently he was appointed as a Jules and Doris Stein Professor in the Cell Biology Department of Cell Biology in Ophthalmology, excuse me. And then he was appointed as a scientific director in the Margaret Dyson Vision Research Institute. And since then, he has been appointed as a Margaret Dyson Professor of Ophthalmic Research in this Vision Research Institute. He's also Professor of Cell and Developmental Biology and Professor of Neurosciences now. And he also was Director of the Vision Training Grant in the department. He has received many awards and honors, and for example, the Irma Herschel Award, the Bensley Outstanding Young Cell Biologist Award, and the Established Investigator Award of the American Heart Association. And we originally had this visit scheduled in November, but he couldn't come, unfortunately for us, but fortunately for him, because he received the highest award that you can receive for as a scientist in Argentina, the Rice Prize. I hope I pronounced that correctly. He has been funded by NIH for over 30 years. He has published 194 publications so far. And I just want to emphasize that his research is really, he has discovered many key processes in apical, basal sorting and trafficking in epithelial cells, and he has made many very exciting and interesting discoveries in RPE cell biology. So this is very important, especially for macular degeneration. And I stop now and let you talk.
Okay, Sabina, thank you very much for the very nice introduction. Yes. Okay, so this project started a few years ago in the lab, and it's part of my intention to do something that is a bit more translational. Most of my work has been at a very basic level, basic cell biology level, the cell biology of epithelial cells, epithelial polarity. And in the lecture I'm going to give later today, I'm going to deal a little bit with that. But this one is more focused, I mean, for this audience on the problem that we have been interested for a while, which is the problem of lipofuscin. How lipofuscin damages the RPE, how lipofuscin causes blindness, and is it possible or not to get some kind of therapy for this type of diseases. So this, by the way, is where I work. This is Weill Cornell Medical College. This is Rockefeller University. This is the East River, Sloan Kettering, Central Park, and this is where I live. Okay, so Stargardt disease is a monogenic disease usually caused by mutations in the ABCR4 transporter. There are large amounts of lipofuscin deposited in the RPE and causes macular dystrophy and blindness by about the fourth decade of life. And this is a clear example, this disease, that lipofuscin is bad for the eye. So what is lipofuscin? We're going to go into that. I mean, in terms of macular degeneration, lipofuscin accumulates with age in all of us. With age, we have an increasing amount of lipofuscin. By the age 70 and above, we may have up to 20% of the cytoplasm occupied by lipofuscin. But whether this is a factor or not in the etiology of AMD is not clear. Although the work by George Hageman and others has clearly shown that AMD is linked to a variety of genes that can predispose to AMD. But lipofuscin in particular and ABCR4 is not particularly linked in that sense. However, there's the possibility that lipofuscin could somehow be one of the contributing aspect factors to develop the disease later on in life. So lipofuscin, what is lipofuscin? Lipofuscin is a fluorescent material that accumulates with age in the RPE. You see this in the section of the retina. This is the RPE. And when you look at a cell loaded with lipofuscin, an RPE cell, you see all of these dotted elements in the cytoplasm. And those dots are lysosomes. So the lipofuscin is a material that accumulates in lysosomes in the RPE. And it also accumulates in many organs, most organs in the body with age. But the lipofuscin that accumulates in the brain, for example, or in the liver, is completely different from the lipofuscin that accumulates in the eye. The steroid lipofuscin that accumulates in the brain, for example, is mostly based on protein. The lipofuscin in the eye is mostly based on lipid. So we know very well that from the work of Young that photoreceptors are continuously regenerating, and it takes about 10 days to move material synthesized in the inner segment to the tip of the outer segment, where it's then phagocytosed by the RPE cell. And in our lab, Sylvia Finneman discovered one of the two major receptors in RPE phagocytosis, the alpha B beta 5 integrin. And with MERTK, these two receptors mediate this daily phagocytosis of outer segments into phagosomes, which are then converted into phagolysosomes and degraded, the material, the outer segments degraded there. Now, the lipofuscin is a consequence of this activity, the activity of phagocytosis, and the activity also of the visual cycle, which is a cooperation between the photoreceptor and the RPE that leads to the production of these bisretinoids. This is shown in this slide in a little more detail. So we get from the blood 11-cis retinol, which is converted into 11-cis retinal and shipped to the photoreceptor, and is a prosthetic group of rhodopsin. So when light hits rhodopsin, 11-cis retinal is released and converted into all transretinal on the inner side of the sac of the in the photoreceptor of the membrane sac. And then ABCR is a flipase that transports all transretinal to the cytosol. Here we have all transretinal is relatively toxic, so there's a mechanism to reduce it through a dehydrogenase into all transretinol. The alcohol is less toxic and is moved to the RPE, where it is through a series of steps isomerized back to 11-cis retinal and shipped back to the photoreceptor. And so that's the visual cycle. Now, a branch of the pathway is the following, that part of the old transretinal doesn't follow this route, but follows an alternative pathway and becomes dimerized and linked to phosphatidylethanolamine, forming these retinoids, which have this V-shaped. Okay, and they are the process is completed in the lysosomes of RPE cells, and these components are relatively very stable, so they can stay for years. They are quite resistant to all known hydrolases. So they are very difficult to do. It's a sort of like a lipid diamond, if you wish. Now, in Stargardt's disease, ABCA4 is mutated, and so this pathway, this alternative pathway, is enhanced enormously, and therefore we have an enormous production of these retinoids. And the accumulation of these retinoids is actually quite toxic. For example, if you can incorporate them in vitro, you can synthesize them, and in this experiment, what we did was to synthesize an A2E or the all trans retinal dimer, two different bisretinoids, and incorporate them into the cells by exposing them to this bisretinoid. So at concentrations that we know result in intracellular levels similar to those of an aging eye, those concentrations, we can see that there's a clear effect on viability of both this RPE cell line and the human fetal RPE cells. So the objectives of this project in our lab are to develop a drug that would remove lipofuscin from RPE. Then if we obtain it, we would like to see whether this drug can stop Stargardt disease in humans. And of course, if we would come to that point, it would be interesting to see whether it has any effect on patients with AMD. So this is A2E, and the way that we started looking for a drug that would bind into E was to use a property of these bisretinoids. These bisretinoids are fluorescent, and the fluorescence, this is the fluorescence in water of A2E, for example. The fluorescence of these bisretinoids enhances when you place them in a medium, in a nonpolar medium. For example, this is the fluorescence in ethanol, this is the fluorescence in DMSO and in hexane. So the most, when the polarity is decreased, the fluorescence is increased. So then we screen drugs that would cause an increase in the fluorescence of the bisretinoids. And one drug that came to mind right away were cyclodextrins, for several reasons. Cyclodextrins are native compounds. They are formed by several units of glucose linked, so that the core, the inner core, is hydrophobic, whereas the external surface is hydrophilic. So we have the alpha cyclodextrin has 6 molecules of glucose, the beta has 7, the gamma has 8. And this is the curve that I showed you before, the fluorescence of A2E in water up to hexane here. And this is what happens when you put A2E in the presence of different cyclodextrins. What you see here is that in the presence of alpha cyclodextrin, there's practically no increase, is the green curve here. With gamma cyclodextrin, the increase is a little bigger, and with beta cyclodextrin, you have the highest increase in fluorescence. So this suggests that the hydrophobic arms of A2E, which are the fluorescent arms of A2E, are being encapsulated within the hydrophobic core of the cyclodextrin. So, and you can use, you can see what is the fluorescence that you get in the reaction as a function of the concentration. This is in micromolars of the different cyclodextrins. So you see that clearly the one that has the highest increase in fluorescence is the beta cyclodextrin, which is relatively not very soluble, than the methyl beta, which is more soluble, so you can use it at higher concentrations. The gamma, you get fluorescence at a higher concentration of cyclodextrin, and the alpha, of course, you don't get any fluorescence. So In a paper that we published last year, we studied different properties of the interaction of bisretinoids with cyclodextrin. So this is a demonstration that when you incubate, when you expose bisretinoids to light or to an oxidative environment, the typical absorbance spectrum of this bisretinoid, this is not fluorescence, but this is absorbance, has two shoulders corresponding to the two arms of A2E. If you expose them to photooxidation, you lose that spectrum, you lose the two shoulders. If you incubate them, the A2E, in the presence of alpha cyclodextrins, you don't protect against the loss, against the effect of oxidation, but beta protects very well. Gamma has an intermediate protection. And the same is true for auto-oxidation, oxidation just by leaving the A2E in a tube for a week, for example. You lose the shoulders, and alpha doesn't protect, beta protects very well, and gamma intermediate protection. So what we did was then to model the interaction between cyclodextrins and A2E. And this was work done in collaboration with Harald Weinstein, who is an informatics, he's the chairman of the physiology department and an expert in this modeling technique. So he helped us with it. And this is how A2E looks, has these two arms, and the short arm, the long arm, and it has a size, a diameter at this level of about, the maximum diameter of about 6.5 angstroms. And here you have the inner diameters of alpha cyclodextrin, beta cyclodextrin, and gamma cyclodextrin. So alpha has an inner diameter of 5.6, so it's clearly too small or to allow penetration of the arm of A2E. Whereas beta cyclodextrin has an inner diameter of 6.8 angstroms, the smaller one. These are toroidal molecules, so they have two. On one side, the diameter is 5.6, on the other side is 8.8. For beta, is 6.8 and 10.8. So this clearly has the right size to accommodate A2E, whereas gamma cyclodextrin is a little large, so the arm enters into the ring, but sort of is not very tight. This modeling work told us that we can get even one or two molecules of cyclodextrin, one per arm. And all of these configurations are possible from the modeling point of view. And one prediction is that beta dimers would bind A2E with higher affinity. And actually, this work done by Ronald Breslow, who is a very prestigious chemist at Columbia University. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences, who several years ago published a very interesting paper in which he studied the interaction of cyclodextrins with different types of substrates, either monomeric substrates or dimeric substrates, some of them V-shaped, like the cyclodextrins. And this work clearly showed that, and this was experimental work of very, very high quality. They produced and tested a whole variety of different cyclodextrins and demonstrated that some cyclodextrins, sorry for it, I keep having problems, cyclodextrins, when you make cyclodextrins like this, a dimer with a fixed angle and so on, you can get affinities which are up to, 10 to the affinity of an antibody for an antigen. So we have eventually the potential of developing very powerful cyclodextrins in the future if we would, and we have been talking to him about going this route. Now, we don't know if affinity is important to have such a high affinity, if that would be helpful for the drug effect or not. At this point, I want to emphasize this point. So what an experiment that Marcelo Nocciari, who led this project, did with Guillermo Lehmann was, as I told you, we can load RPE cells with A2E. And then when you do microscopy on these cells, you can see this type of pattern, which is typical of lysosomes. So you have this yellowish fluorescence of A2E. And when you incubate these cells in the presence of cyclodextrin, you can remove a good amount of it in over a period of 24 to 48 hours. about 50% removal on average. And you can measure that by quantitative microscopy, or you can measure also this by HPLC, which we did in collaboration with Roxana Radu at UCLA. Also, the other experiment that we went, you know, one step ahead, was to do the removal experiment in excised eyes from a mouse, which is a mouse model of Stargardt disease. So it's a mouse that we got from Chris Polchewski. This actually is more than Stargardt because it has a double mutation. It has a mutation in the ABCA4, and it has also a mutation in the dehydrogenase. So it's a double knockout mouse. And these mice accumulate very large amounts of lipofuscin in the RPE. And so what we did was to take the eyes of these mice, enucleate them, so cut them in half, then take the back half of the eye, peel the neural retina, and expose the eye cap, the remaining eye cap, to the cyclodextrin. And then we did measurement quantitative microscopy and HPLC. And we saw that in both cases, about 40-50% removal over a period of 72 hours treatment, measured by a little higher with HPLC. And the removal was, these are the different peaks that you find, different these retinoids, A2E and all transretinal dimer are the most abundant ones, but there are other smaller ones. And it was pretty effective for all of them, the same efficiency for all of them, the removal rate. Then the last step was trying to show an effect in vivo. Here the issue was, what is the best delivery that we can use, the delivery route we can use for the drug. So after talking to several people, we decided to go to use the intravitreal injection of the cyclodextrins, simply because it had been tried for other drugs, and so testing other routes was not so easy to think at this point. Anyway, so this is not so easy experiment. That was a work of Guillermo Lehmann in the lab, who is very good with this type of procedures. And he injected in one of the eyes in the mouse the cyclodextrin, and in the other eye buffer. And we shipped the eyes to Roxana Radu, who can measure the cyclodextrin, just one mouse eye. So the HPLC sensitivity is good enough to measure all of this in one eye. And so this is comparison of pairs of eyes. In every case, we saw about 25 or 30% removal after this type of protocols, several injections in a week. And it was efficient for several different bis retinoids. Now, based on these initial observations, we were invited to submit a proposal to this newly created institute, Transinstitutional Therapeutics Discovery Institute, in which Michael Foley is the director. And this is a new initiative in Cornell in which people researchers who have a project in the so-called Death Valley status, meaning you have a drug, but you have an interesting effect, but you are very far from having a drug that you can use in humans. You need to go through many different steps in between, and Greg can tell you about this very well. So the question is, this is a situation in which, you know, we consulted several different companies, and they said, well, it's a nice, but you need to have more. You know, you are not yet in terms of convincing us that this would be useful in clinical work. So this was a good opportunity because this institute selected our proposal together with a proposal by Fred Maxfield in our institution, who has been using cyclodextrins to treat or to develop a treatment for Niemann-Pick disease. Niemann-Pick disease is a disease in which kids accumulate cholesterol in lysosomes. They cannot get rid of cholesterol because they lack a particular cholesterol transport, Niemann-Pick C protein. So. And that causes death very early in life. And there have been some pretty good successes in working, for example, with cats that develop this disease. doing intrathecal administration of beta-cyclodextrins prevent them from getting the disease. So now they are using this, people are using cyclodextrins to treat some kids who develop the disease, and there's a foundation, Parsegian Foundation, that supports this, because, I mean, the kids are actually Parsegian, you know, they are in the family, and they're desperate to get some kind of treatment. So this has been, and some of the cyclodextrins are actually FDA approved. Cyclodextrins are used as delivery vehicles for drugs. So in a way, that's already a step that has been crossed. And finally, the collaboration in this case involved putting a group of Japanese chemists from Takeda Pharmaceutical in a space in Cornell, and they are helping us develop different derivatives of cyclodextrins. So what is, how can we make cyclodextrins more powerful? Well, the A2E or lipofuscin accumulates in the lysosomes, but so the cyclodextrin has somehow to get from the outside to the lysosome. Under the conditions that we are using them now, they are getting to the lysosome through pinocytosis, or cell drinking. That means it's a very inefficient process. Now, the cells, all cells in the body have this type of conveyor belt to transport lysosomal hydrolases secreted into the medium that have mannose 6-phosphate. They bind to mannose 6-phosphate receptor, and by a process of endocytosis, they reach the lysosome. In principle, one can get a speed of about 100-fold or 1,000-fold bigger using this than the regular pinocytosis. And this is Fred Maxfield, who is interested in getting beta cyclodextrin for the treatment of Niemann-Pick disease. Because we were going to get several different tubes every month to test, we developed a more high throughput type of assay to measure removal of lipofuscin. And this is shown here, so we use CHO cells, which are very easily loaded with lipofuscin. So we load them, the lysosomes are loaded with lipofuscin. Then we expose them to cyclodextrin for 16 to 20 hours, and we stain them with lysotracker for the lysosome. And then we can do quantitative microscopy of the fixation, making the ratio between lysotracker, which marks lysosomes, and A2E fluorescence. And so I'm going to show you some of the drugs that we've tested using this assay. So this is alpha cyclodextrin. As you know, this is too small and doesn't have any efficient removal, doesn't remove A2E from the cell. This is the cyclodextrin that we have been using so far, beta-methyl cyclodextrin. It has a removal effect at concentrations of about 500 micromolar. This is the monoamino cyclodextrin that is used by the chemist as a first step in the production of the other cyclodextrins. This one doesn't have a very efficient removal capacity. This is one cyclodextrin in which mannose 6-phosphate was added as a ligand to the drug. And here you have a removal capacity at least 10 or 50 times higher than the original cyclodextrin. So now it's in the order of the micromolar range. This is another variation of mannose 6-phosphate cyclodextrin, also pretty efficient removal. A different variation of mannose 6-phosphate, also pretty efficient removal. When two mannose 6-phosphate tags were added, the removal was sort of all over, so not very good, so this is not helping the process. And so by using now the fluorescence of the A2E of these retinoids, we were able to measure the affinity of the cyclodextrin for the particular A2E. And so this is what I showed you before, the fluorescence of A2E in the presence of alpha, beta, gamma, or the different HP betas or M beta cyclodextrins, different cyclodextrins. And these are the affinities. So methyl beta cyclodextrin, for example, is in the one that we have been using, is in the order of 10 to the 7 × 10⁻⁴. So it's in the order of micromolar, and high micromolar range, low millimolar range. Addition of mannose-6-phosphate actually decreases the affinity. The KD goes higher. So even when the affinity is decreased, we have a much higher removal capacity. And this is probably because we have the ability to get the cell, the drug faster into the lysosomes. And so one interesting observation here is that this some product that came up from this screen is an azidocyclodextrin. This one has a pretty high affinity compared to the other ones, but doesn't have mannose-6-phosphate, but however can remove very efficiently, almost as efficiently as the mannose-6-phosphate. So we're interested in this product as well. So as I mentioned before, it may be possible to get cyclodextrins that have an affinity of 10 to the 11, 10 to the minus 11, a KD of 10 to the minus 11. Again, we don't know if that would be good or not. You know, that's something that we have to test. We don't know, and that's because we don't know what is the mechanism that the cyclodextrin is using to remove the lipofuscin from the cell. So in conclusions, so far, a single mannose-6-phosphate tax improved considerably the potency of CDs to remove A2E. Introduction of mannose-6-phosphate tax reduces tenfold the affinity of CDs for A2E, and nonetheless, they are still much more efficient. And in some cases, we see that higher affinity of CD for A2E correlates positively with removal potency, even in the absence of mannose-6-phosphate tags. So clearly, what we would like to do in the future is to understand more about the mechanism of action of cyclodextrins. How do they penetrate the lysosomal compartment of RPE? Do they promote lysosomal exocytosis? Lysosomes are not immobile organelles. They are very dynamic organelles. And now in the last few years, the work by Andrea Balabio in Naples has shown that lysosomes have a tremendous flexibility in terms of response to different situations that the cell has to respond to. So is it that the cyclodextrins, we don't really know how they work. I mean, one possibility is that the lysosomes may be now fusing in higher amounts with the cell surface and removing this to the exterior. Or another possibility is that somehow the cyclodextrins are promoting transfer from the lysosomal compartment to a different compartment in the cell where the lipofuscin can be degraded. And actually, in that sense, there's an interesting experiment that was reported. We were at some point interested in studying, could we get some kind of hydrolase that would degrade A2E or lipofuscin? I told you that it's very difficult. And one idea that we had was maybe we can go to an expert, microbiologist who has a collection of different bacteria. And since there are some bacteria that can degrade oil, it may be possible to find some bacteria that would degrade lipofuscin. And actually, we had already made a contact, and a paper came out in which someone else had the same idea. And actually, Janet Sparrow collaborated with that work. And interestingly, they found that some peroxidase can degrade lipofuscin. And this is interesting because peroxidase are concentrated in the peroxisomal compartment in the cell. So one possibility is that somehow, one possibility in terms of mechanism of action is that the cyclodextrins are promoting transfer out of the lysosome to peroxisomes where they may be degraded faster. So that's a clear possibility for the future. Anyway, so what we need to do next is obviously to find a way to study removal, not only removal of lipofuscin from the eye in animals, but also to restoration of vision, right? So that would be the next step. Can we restore vision? Can we prevent loss of vision by this treatment? And there are many issues, administration route, then with developing optimized high cyclodextrins, et cetera. And we have to consider in this is that the mannose-6-phosphate receptor in most cells is expressed on the basolateral surface of epithelial cells. So in the case of RPE, in this sense, administrating cyclodextrins from the vitreous would have to get first to the apical surface of RPE through the neural retina. And that's and we don't have a receptor there. So that wouldn't be a good route of administration in that sense. It would be better to come from the scleral side in that sense. So and this localization of -6-phosphate in RPE is clearly basolateral, and there's a lot of it inside the cell in the lysosomal compartment. And this is a co-distribution of -6-phosphate with a basolateral marker in RPE. So again, another view of the basolateral localization in lysosome. So in terms of in vivo experiments, so we made we started a collaboration with Glenn Prusky, who is a vision physiologist working in a different in the Center for Visual Restoration in Burke Institute, which is part of Cornell University in Westchester, a little bit upstate. And so he developed this technique to measure vision in mice, optokinetic tracking, that you may know, you have heard about. So in this technique, the mouse is placed in a platform in the center of the of a virtual cylinder that moves around the mouse with stripes, and the stripes can vary in intensity, contrast, speed, and so on. So you can measure two parameters called spatial frequency and contrast sensitivity. So these are the DKO mice at 200 days old, 600 days old. We can see that there's a continuous increase in lipofuscin in the eye. And at 700 days old, that's when we see that the first evidence of damage to the RPE cell. This is almost 2 years old mouse. Up to this point, there was no damage noticeable to RPE cells, but at this time we see that the RPE cells become larger, indicating that many of the cells have died, and the other cells are occupying the space. Interestingly, when we do the visual function tests, what we see is that using spatial frequency as a parameter, the vision of these mice is normal up to about 600 days, and decays very drastically between 600 and 700 days. This would be the control mice. They have a much more gradual decrease of vision at this point. In terms of contrast sensitivity, this is a bad part of this. We had accumulated all of these mice over 3 years, and so we were able to send them mice of different ages so they could do these measurements. But obviously, this is not an easy model to work with if you have to wait 200 days to 700 days to do the experiment. So there are ways to improve the model. You know, we think that if we would expose the mice to more light, probably they would develop to regular levels of light. You know, because the levels of light that you have in the mouse room are pretty low. You would have a faster development of the disease. Anyway, so we saw that there's some loss of contrast sensitivity with age. These are mice of about 300 days old, and 380 goes here. So this shoulder disappears after 300 days. So this is a little better. It's 1 year instead of 2 years, but still pretty long in terms of looking for a model. So, and our first experiments in trying to inject intravitreally the drug into mice didn't show. This was just one injection, and looking 7 days later, just to do some trials, we didn't see so much effect in the spatial frequency, but we saw a small prevention of the for three mice in the decrease of the contrast sensitivity from here. Instead of going here, went here for three mice. It's a very small effect, and it's also one initial trial. So in conclusion, using a screening assay for small molecules that interact with A2E, we identified beta cyclodextrins, which are small oligosaccharide rings with a toroidal hydrophobic cavity. Beta cyclodextrins, but not alpha or gamma, prevent quenching of A2E fluorescence by water, and prevent their photooxidation. The protective function of these beta cyclodextrins originate in the ability to encapsulate the hydrophobic arms of A2E into their hydrophobic cavity. Beta cyclodextrins can remove A2E from RPE cells, but the mechanisms are still unclear. Single mannose 6-phosphate tags improve considerably the potency of CDs to remove A2E in vitro. In the future, so we would like to test beta cyclodextrins and improve derivatives for recovery or prevention of vision function in DKO mice. Eventually, if this works, we would like to test them in Stargardt patients. A form of beta cyclodextrin is already FDA approved and is being used to treat patients with Niemann-Pick disease. If beta cyclodextrins are effective in Stargardt, obviously it would be interesting to test them in patients with atrophic AMD. Marcelo Nocciari and Guillermo Lehmann did a lot of the work reported here. Chris Barnes, a graduate student, also participated in the last group of experiments with mannose-6-phosphate. Collaborators I mentioned, Fred Maxfield, Harry Weinstein, Cillar Keys, who advises on, is a clinical assistant professor who advises with Stargardt disease. David Warren and Matthews helped with the PNAS paper as the chemistry of cyclodextrins. We have a patent filed and published in August 2014. We received funding from all of these places. And this is the Transinstitutional Discovery Institute with Michael Foley and the group of Takeda chemists who have been helping us. Thank you very much, and I'm glad to answer any questions. Yes, can we have light? Yeah, you mean kinetic model to study binding?
Yeah.
Yeah, for the binding, we studied the property of fluorescence of the cyclodextrin, and the fluorescence increases when they are sort of better protected from the water by the hydrophobic cyclodextrin. So somehow. Yeah, we didn't go beyond studying the KD or the, but I mean, what we are interested in doing is really trying to see whether, to understand more about the biology of the system, because we don't know really anything about the removal process. Clearly, they are not there anymore. So they've disappeared. So they cannot be detected by HPLC in the eye after you apply the cyclodextrins. So where are they gone? Where did they go? They go out. So we are trying to figure out if they are removed out of the cell intact, or were they degraded? So and I mentioned the possibility that they could be shipped to a different organelle. And actually, in the case of Niemann-Pick disease, it's known that when you add cyclodextrins to the, that's the theory that Fred Maxley has. When you add cyclodextrins to the lysosome, somehow they fulfill the role of the missing Niemann-Pick protein, which was actually to move cholesterol from the lumen of the lysosome to the membrane of the lysosome so that it can be shipped out of the lysosome. So something like this may be happening also for A2E. I mean, maybe they are sort of clustered in some kind of a crystal in the lumen of the, because these are hydrophobic compounds in the lumen of the lysosome, and when you add the cyclodextrin, you are helping it dissolve and maybe reach a different compartment in the cell. We don't know. So, and also we've seen, for example, that we're interested in seeing what is the mechanism of cell death, because that could give us an additional tool to use in the future. If we understand how the cells are being killed, are they being killed by ER stress or by what is the process that is going on? We may have additional ways to work downstream from cyclodextrins. Yes, Sabina.
Do you have any means to see how good the cyclodextrins get into
Well, I mean, our friends, we became pretty good friends with the Japanese chemists. They are producing now fluorescent cyclodextrins, so we can really follow them. And so that's part of the project right now, to see whether we can follow the distribution in the eye. Yeah, sure. Greg.
So, Enrique, wonderful talk, as always. I should know the answer to this, but A2E and its derivatives aside, the composition of lipofuscin and Stargardt's and non-Stargardt's, similar? Do you know?
You mean Stargardt's versus?
Versus non-Stargardt's, just.
Like not in the eye, or in
the eye.
In the eye. Or how similar is let's say, how similar is the Stargardt's lipofuscin versus the eye aging lipofuscin? Yeah, I don't know that there's a complete study on that, but I think that many aspects of the lipofuscin are similar in the sense they have A2E, all trans, the dimer, all trans retinal dimer. But there are other things also. There's the so-called melanolipofuscin. There are other components. And I'm not sure, really, on how different they are. And I'm not sure that it's very well explained in the literature. So, yeah.
Thank you very much.
OK, thank you very much.